rise to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav eilecha v'chunecha. Yisa Adonai panav eilecha v'yisem lecha shalom.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. It's wonderful to have all of you here with us this morning. If you could take a moment and fill out the welcome card in the pew in front of you so that we know you're here, we would greatly appreciate that. And for those of you worshiping on Facebook, if you could say hi in the comments so that we know you are here. University Lutheran is a reconciling in Christ congregation, which means we accept you just as you are, created in the image and likeness of God. So, obviously, you all know that this morning is our last Sunday for Pastor Haley Bay and Bryn and Eva being with us. And on one hand, I know you're all sad. I'm really sad. Haley Bay has been just an incredible colleague, a good friend, and a really trusted partner in ministry. At the same time, I'm really, as we all are, grateful for your ministry with us and excited for you all in new opportunities. So after worship today, you probably saw as you came in, we'll have a reception for you. It'll be a chance for you to greet them and say farewell. So please take some time and stay for that. A couple other announcements is in the worship this morning, there is a liturgical dance, and this liturgical dance was done in the first worship expression service that we did back in 2018, and it was done on the Sunday that we installed Pastor Haley Bay as associate pastor here. Different dancer, but the same dance. And then the bells are going to be playing later, and Emma Repp, there she is in the back. This will be her last Sunday also playing bells with us because she and Andrew are headed to North Carolina. I always get North and South Carolina mixed up for Andrew's new position there as a professor. With that then, celebrations. Any celebrations going on, Facebook or here in the congregation? I know John Andersland has a birthday this week. And Andrew? Hey, congratulations. Wow. Wonderful news. Thank you for sharing that. Any other celebrations? I mean, how do you top that one? All right, with that then, we'll begin our worship with the prelude. Thank you. John Dale has always slipped in when we've done a run through of the service, his little jingle bells and stuff, and he finally did it in worship. I invite you, it was for Haley Ray, yeah. I invite you to stand for the call to worship. Open our senses to receive your voice. Open our hearts to receive your prophecy. Open our minds to recognize your truth. We are paying attention, O God. Help show us the way. We join together in singing the first three verses of All Are Welcome, which is on the screen, and hymn 641, but the first three verses. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Peace. and celebration. All of creation sings for joy to the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. For God has come to dwell with us, to make us people of God, to make all things new. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy to the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore.
Let us pray. God of all, we are daily bombarded with conflicting messages about what is meaningful and valuable. Clear away the noise and distraction that we might discern your voice as it calls us into your work of love and justice for all your beloved children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the gospel acclamation.
Our reading this morning from 2 Peter is a letter to the church about paying attention to signs. Signs from false prophets and teachers that require a focus on themselves and their teachings, and signs from God that point to Jesus and the teacher who we are called to follow. It's a bit curious to me that 2 Peter is a letter of warning signs about following false teachings, written not by Peter himself, but by someone who's writing in Peter's name. Now, although this was an accepted practice in those days, certainly it's a curious thought, especially since the context of this letter is that the author believes these may be his last words to the church. So the writer speaks with urgency, reminding readers of things they may already know, but things that are important for them to remember after he is gone. They will need to remember God's promises first and foremost, then support one another in faith, live out their call and focus on Jesus over false prophets and false teachers as they prepare for the day of the Lord, even when it's difficult to do so. But they have each other, and they have Jesus as their guiding light. This is a reading from 2 Peter. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but by men and women and people of God moved by the Holy Spirit who spoke from God. But false prophets also rose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive opinions. They will even deny the master who brought them, bringing swift destruction on themselves. Even so, many will follow their licentious ways, and because of these teachers, the way of truth will be maligned. They have left the straight road and have gone astray, following the road of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved the wages of wrongdoing, but was rebuked for his own transgression. A speechless donkey spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These are waterless springs and mist driven by a storm. For them, the deepest darkness has been reserved. For they speak bombastic nonsense, and with licentious desires of the flesh, they entice people who have just escaped from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For people are slaves to whatever masters them. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. So I was having a little trouble coming up with what to say today. It's not often that one prepares to preach a farewell sermon. So I was experiencing some writer's block. But then I read the text again for this morning and remembered it's not about me. It's about Jesus. And that's when things started to come together. Now, you probably already know that I did not choose the assigned reading for today, because if I chose the text, I would not have chosen this one. But I know that one of the truly amazing aspects of following a lectionary, the assigned readings to the church year, is that you don't choose the readings. In a sense, the readings choose you. And the Spirit is up to something good with this one. This letter from 2 Peter contains what the author believed to be his last words shared publicly in the church. He actually had reason to believe he would die soon, so while not entirely aligned, God willing, this is my last sermon among you, and the season of ministry that we have shared up to now is coming to a close. It's a bittersweet time. In my letter to our congregation, I wrote that I consider serving as one of your pastors at ULC, one of the greatest gifts and blessings of my life and career. And I thank you for helping me grow as pastor, colleague, and friend, and child of God. As I look around the room and see those of you also gathered here for online worship, I recognize the gift of being called into this community and into your lives of faith. Among all of the baptisms, marriage celebrations, memorial services, hospital visits, conversations over lunch and coffee, emails, text messages, Fridays at 5, Sunday fun days, worship Wednesday, youth group, staff and council and committee meetings, racial justice workshops, service trips around the country. We have celebrated and sustained so many valuable ministry opportunities together in Christ's name. And that's a lot to celebrate and be thankful for. Amen? You finally got it. While these may be some of my last words to publicly share among you for now, like this letter being written to a community that will live beyond the writer's words, I am understanding it as a particularly poignant part of the narrative of Scripture to share this letter among us today. Just yesterday, a friend who has a science and math teaching background asked me, and who is also a person of faith, asked, "How do you have the faith and science talk with students on campus?" And I said, well, we make connections instead of divisions. Because God loves science and faith, just as God loves you and me. There is more to connect than there is to divide, which is the trouble that the author of 2 Peter is pointing out, and not the good trouble that Representative John Lewis is known for speaking about. This trouble comes when people impose their own interpretation on Scripture. False prophets and teachers lure people with empty promises. Lies too often try to lure us in as truth, making divisions instead of connections between people, faith, and life. In spite of all this, the writer says, hold on to God's precious and very great promises. Grow in faith by practicing goodness, knowledge, self-control, endurance, godliness, mutual affection, and love, which sound a lot to me like the fruits of the Spirit. Treasure God's word revealed in Scripture. Wait with faith and hope for what is to come. Because Christ has promised, not suggested, promised new life to you and every generation. And even though it may seem impossible to scientifically parse out or justify, Christ has promised to come again. So if having faith in Jesus means to believe and live like seemingly impossible things are possible, like Jesus dying for our sins and being raised from the dead, like getting through a pandemic as a congregation, not only surviving, but thriving, thanks be to God. And as a synod, willing to try new things and pivot when necessary. Like choosing to remember Jesus' promise of new life, even as a pastoral transition, could have the potential to plant seeds of doubt in the minds of the faithful. The writer of 2 Peter reminds the church, you will do well to be attentive to this, as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. With Jesus as our morning star, his light shines through the church. That's you and that's me. Not only on Sunday morning, and not only here in East Lansing, but every day and everywhere that we go as children of God, with the light of Christ illuminating our hearts through faith. 2 Peter reminds us that to be the church in a world where death and destruction are everywhere is a unique and precious opportunity. To be people called to share a message of hope in hellish times, to preach good news to the poor, freedom to the oppressed, and to not only preach but act according to what we believe, to actually live like followers of Jesus, to help reorient each other when we go astray, to speak the truth in love and not be afraid, to be readily aware and willing to shine a light on all the ways that seemingly impossible things are possible because of Jesus and his love. Because of Jesus, we get the opportunity to witness and remember how God brings new life to every generation. New light into dimly lit spaces. Even when there will be people who try to convince us otherwise. Perhaps you have a few naysayers in your life who point to their own opinions and interpretations as gospel truth instead of Jesus. But the question I'd like to offer today is, what if even the naysayers can be a sign for you and me? A sign that Jesus is already Emmanuel, God with us, and still to come. What if instead of a stumbling block, we consider that the changes and challenges of this life our Jesus still coming and living among us, a sign that reconciliation and resurrection still have room to grow, a sign that seemingly impossible people and situations are certainly out there, no doubt, and that God is able. God is able to deliver on God's promises of renewed vision and hope more than those false prophets and teachers ever will. So the writer of this letter may have written under a pseudonym. But I wonder, perhaps instead of false pretense, could it have been a gospel tool to point readers and hearers and doers of Scripture throughout the generations, instead of to himself and his words, but away from false teachings and directly toward the one whose word brings new life and freedom to all people? The writer speaks without question. There will be false teachers among you, those who will secretly bring in destructive opinions. Beware. But so it is the opportunity then of the people of God, the church, moved by the power of the Holy Spirit, to discern together, where are we willing to be led? Where are we willing to go? Where are we being called to be the church? To magnify the light of Jesus shining, making connections, practicing freedom for all who are oppressed, not as slaves of corruption ourselves, but as people willing to choose a life with Jesus, the Savior of the world. In my 10.5 years of ordained ministry, I've been part of this community for 6 of those, almost to the week, actually, when I started on a contract serving here in campus ministry August 1st, 2017. I was later called in April of the following year. During this time together, I have grown as pastor, partner, and parent. And I feel blessed and encouraged that as I transition out of my call as your pastor, there are people who are stepping forward to care for the ministries that we have shared. Ministry that was around way before I ever came. And some ministries that are new. And ministry that will continue because this congregation understands, I believe, that to be the church in a world where death and destruction and false teachings about Jesus are everywhere, it is our unique opportunity and precious, powerful gift that we've been given to shine a light on the gospel truth, to tell everyone, Jesus loves you. So for now, I just want to conclude by saying thank you. Thank you for calling me. And thanks be to God for you. Amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. tells me so. Jesus loves me and he holds me close when I am hurting and I'm all alone. I can trust his matchless grace, for he leads me
invite you to rise as you're comfortable, as with the whole church, we profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue now with the prayers of the church, mindful that our response to each petition is receive our prayer. You may also enter any prayer requests that you have now online, and there will be an opportunity to do that after the petitions out loud as well.
New to our prayer list this week is Nancy Lindman. Freed by Christ and led by the Spirit, let us offer our prayers to God for the world, the church, and all those in need. Almighty Father, we unite our hearts in prayer, seeking your guidance and strength. Let not the beauty of the earth the glory of the skies, or the love that surround us daily, blind us to the needs of all your people. May we be aware of false prophets among us and only be moved by the Holy Spirit speaking from you. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
Loving Father, today we once again come to you bowed down and wearied by the all too frequent and senseless acts of gun violence in our country. Help our leaders to find a common solution to these killings among our cities and people. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
God of our fathers, in whose name our nation was conceived, under whose banner it was born, and by whose spirit it continues to live in liberty under law, we pray that we may be worthy of the blessing so abundantly bestowed upon us. As we just celebrated the birthday of our independence, we acknowledge our dependence on you for your guiding spirit. We pray that our freedom will lead us to make a great nation of moral character and justice. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
Everlasting Father, faced with great new tasks, we pray for the well-being of this congregation. Make us faithful in the work you have entrusted to our hands. We pray for Elizabeth, our presiding bishop, Greg, our bishop, our pastors Gary and Haley Bay, and our prayer partner, the Reverend Richard Steve of Trinity Lutheran Church in Frankfort, Michigan, as we all gather under your cross for worship today. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
Heavenly Father, the scriptures are filled with stories of people who have been called to move to new places. Filled with uncertainty about what lay ahead, they were also filled with excitement, trusting that God was calling them to a new place. And now our beloved Haley Faye is preparing to leave us and go to a new place, a new home, and a new church. As part of this body of Christ over the past years, Haley Bay, you have given of yourself in ways that we have appreciated, and we will miss you. We ask for God's blessing in your new journey. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
Hear our prayers for all of our members, relatives, and friends in need of your comfort, strength, and healing in body, mind, or spirit, especially care. Annalise, Steve, Bob, Emily, Connor, Bruce, Michael, Ed, Carl, Joseph, Kim, and Nancy Lindman. Give each continued strength to put their trust in you. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
God of all grace, we give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith. You have swallowed up death forever through the resurrection of your Son. Comfort all who mourn, especially the Cicada family, that by casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer. For whom or what else shall we pray today? We give thanks for the love that Emma and Andrew share and pray that as they leave this congregation for the next chapter in their life together, that you will go with them, ahead of them, and behind them, supporting them. Into your hands, loving God, we lift all for whom we pray. Confident in your grace and mercy through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of peace with one another. As we continue now with the offering, I invite you to be seated. Our ushers will be around with the offering plates. You may give for the first time or continue giving with your offering in the offering plate, or there are options on the screen, direct deposit, the donate button through PayPal on our website, or by mailing a check to the church office. The ways that we are generous with what we have help provide for the whole church here and around the world. And our outreach of the month, Connie Lankowski is here today as a representative from the Honduras for Life ministry. That's a ministry of our synod that she is deeply connected with, and she's here to share about that outreach.
Bishop Satterley says in his book, You Are Witnesses of These Things, the best way to preserve and promote church is to reach out to people to whom church is already important. When I read that, I immediately thought of our friends in the Honduran Lutheran Church who have been companions with our synod for 23 years. Our Honduran friends share their faith, their hope in the future, and their joy in worship with us. I always come home not only thankful for my life, but thankful for the opportunity to share in their life. They are a resourceful people who, even in their suffering, and maybe because of their suffering, find hope and joy in each other and in Jesus. As companion partners, we work together and support each other for a common good, in this case, the health of people in their communities. We help our Honduran friends promote healthy living by educating volunteers and by increasing access to life's basic needs. The topics for the workshops we offer are requested by the volunteers depending on the needs in their communities. An example, children needed food, so we taught parents about nutrition and preparing healthy meals. Now we give money for food and parents prepare a meal for their children. But the program continues to grow. One community has started a garden, so they have fresh vegetables for the children. Volunteers weigh and measure the children twice a year, monitoring their growth and development. One of the more recent projects is offering friendships to an HIV/AIDS support group. When the ICLH first contacted the group, they were hesitant to form a relationship. No one had ever wanted to be involved with them. Fortunately, the groups connected, and now four different support groups have friendships with the ICLH volunteers. This project requires nothing but time and compassion for others. The Honduran men and women volunteers are the heart of this ministry. Using information that we provide during the workshops, the volunteers are empowered to help their neighbors. I like to say, when we leave, the real work begins as the volunteers go out into their communities. They are always available and do make a difference. Thank you.
Tú has venido al río, no has buscado ni sabios ni ricos. Solo quieres que yo te siga, Señor. me has mirado a los ojos, sonriendo, has dicho mi nombre en la arena, he dejado mi barca junto a ti. Buscaré otro mar. You have come down to the lake shore, seeking neither the wise nor the wealthy, but only asking for me to follow. Sweet Lord, you have looked into my eyes, kindly smiling. You've called out my name. On the sand, I've abandoned my small boat. Now with you, I will seek other seas. Tú sabes bien lo que tengo en mi barco. No hay oro, no espadas, tan solo redes y mi trabajo. Riendo, has dicho mi nombre en la arena, he dejado mi barca junto a ti, buscaré otro mar. You who have fished other waters, you the longing of souls that are yearning. Loving friend, you've come to call me. Sweet Lord, you have looked into my eyes, kindly smiling. You've called out my name. On the sand, I've abandoned my small boat. Now with you, I will seek other seas. Junto a ti, buscaré otro mar.
Of your love.
Let us pray together. Holy God, we offer now our gifts
and our tithes, not just financial, but our time and our unique and precious gifts, all of which you have first given us. Receive them as a sign of our faithfulness and use them according to your will for the good of all creation. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Maker, Redeemer, and Healer, in the harmonious world of your creation, the plants and animals, the seas and stars were whole and well in your praise. When sin had scarred the world, you sent your Son to heal our ills and to form us again into one. In the night in which he was betrayed by a friend, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of your sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his acts of healing, his body given up, and his victory over death, we await that day when all the people of the earth will come to the river to enjoy the tree of life. Send your Spirit upon us and this meal we share. As grains scattered on the hillside become one bread, so let your church be gathered from the ends of the earth, that all may be fed with the bread of life, your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Creator, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. You may be seated. I invite the communion assistants to come forward at this time. For communion this morning, our ushers will invite you to come forward down the center aisle to receive the bread, which is gluten-free, and then to proceed either to receive the wine or the grape juice, putting your cups in the waste baskets that are provided, returning to your seats by the side aisle. If coming forward for communion is a challenge, we do hope that you'll let one of our ushers know so they can communicate with Pastor Gary or me, and we can meet you where you are with communion. Please rise as you're comfortable. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, our life, our strength, our food, we give you thanks for sustaining us with the body and blood of your Son. By your Holy Spirit, enliven us to be his body in the world, that more and more we will give you praise and serve your earth and its many peoples. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
Pastor Haley Vaig, on April 15, 2018, we of University Lutheran Church called you to be pastor in this place, proclaim God's word, to baptize and teach, to announce God's forgiveness, and to preside at the Lord's table. With the gospel, you have comforted us in times of sickness and trouble, and at the death of our loved ones, sharing our joys and sorrows. You have been an important to our life together in the Church of Jesus Christ, in service to this community, and in God's mission to the whole world. As you leave this community of faith, we say farewell and pray for God's blessings for you in the future. People of God, members of University Lutheran Church, do you release Pastor Haley Vaig from service as your pastor? If so, will you respond, "We do, and we give thanks to God for our ministry together." We do. We do, and we give thanks to God for our ministry together. And Pastor Haley Vaig, do you recognize and accept the completion of your ministry with University Lutheran Church? And if so, will you respond, "I do, and I give thanks to God for our ministry together."
I do, and I give thanks to God for our ministry together.
Let us pray. Almighty God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you gave the holy apostles many gifts and commanded them to feed your flock. You equip your people with abilities that differ according to the grace given to them, and you call them to various avenues of service. We give you thanks for the ministry of Haley Vaig among the people of God in this place. You watch over our going out and our coming in. Bless this time of ending and beginning. You surround your people in every time and place. Keep us close in your love. You accompany your people in times of joy and times of trial. Prosper all that has been done to your glory in this time together. Heal and forgive all that has fallen short of your will for us. Help Haley Vaig and her family and all of us to live with courage and gladness in the future you give to us. As she has been a blessing to us, so now send her forth to be a blessing to others. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I just want to say a couple things. When I first came here to University Lutheran Church, I was excited about the concept of team ministry, because I had never had that. I never had a colleague. But I was also a little worried, like, who would I get to work with? Would this person be a dud? would I have to hold their hand and guide them? But Haley Vaig turned into an absolute dream colleague, someone I grew to trust incredibly. Whenever there were really significant decisions, I always wanted your input, because you are wise and mature well beyond your years of ministry and age, and you have just been an absolute gift to me, and I know to this whole congregation. I'll make sure I said everything I wanted to say. But you've also become a dear friend, so thank you for all you've done here.
Thank you. Do you want a sweaty hug? We're so sweaty up here. Thank you, Gary. Can we do the blessing now, or do we do something?
No, if you want to say anything at this point.
Oh, you know, the one word and sort of phrase that has been hitting me as I've discerned this transition in call is that while we are leaving, we are still loving all of you very deeply, and that that is a real gift. You know, I've known plenty of people who leave places and they're like, good riddance. And I couldn't feel further from that way. I love you all very much. I will continue praying for you and your families. And I hope that you'll come visit us. It's not a bad place to visit. So, and also about the people that I've gotten to work with on a daily basis. Janine and Pastor Gary, as a lead staff, the only way I can sufficiently talk about our partnership is that it's unmatched. And I feel very grateful for the gifts that they bring to the table that help me shine even brighter. And that's a true and wonderful ministry team. So thank you all for this opportunity. When I say thank you for calling me as your associate pastor, I mean that. And I love the relationships that we've shared. And, you know, even though I'm no longer your pastor, those relationships can continue to give life in some really wonderful ways. So thank you.
Bobby Davis, there you are. And we want to invite Eva to come on up, too.
Aww.
And maybe Bryn, too.
As you know, we can't let anyone go without a quilt, right? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. This is a reading from John, chapter 14. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them. And we will come to them and make our home with them." My confirmation verse. This is a reading from Philippians. "I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ." Catherine, you want to wrap her up? Pastor Haley Bay Beeman, you came to make your home with us these past 6 years. Receive this quilt as an expression of love and support by your brothers and sisters in Christ in University Lutheran Church. When you wrap yourself in this quilt, and Bryn, you too, may you know that we want you to be warmed and wrapped in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for bringing Pastor Haley Bate to us. Enfold her in your loving embrace and guide her safely to her new congregation in home in Northern Michigan. Amen. And this is for you, Eva.
Aww.
Okay.
You get one too, baby. Can I get one? Look at
that. This is a reading from Mark. "People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, 'Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it.' And he took them up in his arms, and he laid his hands on them and blessed them." Eva Kay, receive this quilt as an expression of love and support by your brothers and sisters at University Lutheran Church. When you wrap yourself in this quilt, may you be warmed and wrapped in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your gifts of strength and life, and especially the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Enfold Eva Kay in your loving embrace and grant her comfort, joy, and friends in her new home in northern Michigan. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
Then I want to invite Rick Milligan and Louise. Rick is our president, and Louise Montag, our treasurer, to come up.
Yes, you can go down now, baby. Thank you. Thank you.
On behalf of the congregation, we'd like to show our appreciation for your years of service with these gifts.
Thank you.
So, sure, thank you. So we have a few gifts for you, Pastor Haley Bay. A little bit to remember us by, a photo collage, and then a necklace with the MSU helmet. So some remembrance, and then well wishes for moving, transitioning to your new home. We have a nice basket, Michigan Up North basket, and a financial gift. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Sorry. Thank you all so much. This is so special. And all of the pictures are like throughout the years and of different ministries. Emma Jenny even is on it. You didn't see it. Oh, my gosh. Thank you so much. And please, everyone, check out the cake that's on the table out there. It's... again, the MSU helmet in rainbow. It's beautiful. So thank you all so much. Can I put this like here for me? I invite you to rise as you're comfortable. And may you receive this blessing with an open heart. May the... oh, do you want to sing with me? That would be fun. Let's do it. Ready?
May the Lord bless and keep you. May God's face shine upon you. And be gracious... and give you peace.
Amen. We go forth in song with the same song that we started with. This time we're singing verses 4 and 5. All are welcome.
Let us be.